Okay, well, it's 7:01, so let's get the meeting started. Good morning. I'd like to welcome you, all of you here today, where we meet to improve lives locally and globally. I am the president of the most awesome and fun Rotary Club of North St. Paul, Maplewood, Oakdale. Bruce Mogren, would you recite the Pledge of Allegiance?
Sure. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Bruce.
You're welcome.
Claudia Nicholson, would you lead us in the 4- or 5-way test?
The 4- or 5-way test of the things we think, say, or do. First, is it the truth? Second, is it fair to all concerned? Third, will it build goodwill and better friendships? Four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? And finally, 5, is it fun?
Yay. Thank you, Claudia. Anne, would you lead us in an invocation or words of encouragement? Anne, you're muted, Anne.
Yep. Okay, there. Yeah, this morning I would really like to take this time to thank all of you for putting Jack's name on the stone on the in Rotary Park. It has been almost 5 years since his death, and several of you don't even know who he was. I'm so deeply touched by the very kind and generous intentions of the club members to remember Jack in this way and recognize him as a Rotarian and friend. That is high praise coming from all of you, his friends and fellow hardworking Rotarians who give of yourselves so willingly to make lives of others better. He really enjoyed your camaraderie and friendships, and working with you on worthwhile projects and getting to know and enjoy you and others in this neighborhood, and also meeting and getting to know people that we met through the Rotary Exchange programs that this club hosted. It really gives you an understanding of the huge impact Rotary has globally. Thank you so much for remembering Jack. He would be so proud, and he would want us to do 5 on the motto, have fun. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, and our children's and grandchildren's too. I want to share one of Jack's favorite words. It came from the Dorothy Moulter Museum up in Ely. I'll show it to you. Can you see that?
Oh, yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And he would have said it with another little phrase added onto it. He would have said, quit your belly aching, goddammit. That's who Jack was.
Well, what does that word mean?
Quit your belly aching. Quit your complaining.
Oh, okay.
And I also want to do a great big thank you to Joe Miller and Mo Anderson, Sean and Randy Greenlee and Anita and all who worked on the park project over the years. Lots of hours were put into bringing this park to life with the city of North St. Paul. And I want to end with to pray for our country, that we may have compassion, understanding, unity, and peace. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. Jack was a wonderful and fun person and Rotarian, and we all miss him.
Thank you.
Okay. Randy Greeley, do you have a wake-up quiz question?
I do have a question this morning. And this is a rerun from 2013 of Beck's of people who passed in 2012. So let's see how quickly we've forgotten. So I was born in 1922, Philadelphia, of Russian Jewish immigrants, and died in 2012. After serving in the Army during World War II, I moved to New York City to start my acting career.
Michael Landon.
I had a roommate named Charles Bronson. Beginning on Beginning on the stage in the 1940s, I got parts on Broadway in The Sunshine Boys and The Odd Couple.
Jack Lemmon. Jack Lemmon.
Walter Matthau.
In life, throat cancer stole my voice, but after a few years of hard work, I made it back to the stage in Three Men on a Horse.
Jack Klugman.
Jack Klugman is correct, and
wow, I
didn't totally forget. Good going, Claudia. You are awake.
Yeah.
Now, if you'd have said his name, his one of his characters was named Quincy, we'd have had you.
Yeah, that was coming up later, as well as the TV version of Odd Couple.
For folks. Thanks, Randy. From Sergeants of Arms, Randy Comfort, Joel Stallman, and Myra Alberto Medina. Take it away.
Hey, and we're all here today.
Good morning, Sleepyhead.
Sleepyhead. I'll take that nickname. I slept in last week and didn't even show up. I'm so sorry. It happens, right?
That's a fine there, Joel.
I know, it's a fine. I have a lot of fines to pay probably this week.
You are fine, Joe.
You know what I was most worried about, though, when I woke up at 7:30? I had invited a guest, and I was wondering if she showed up or not, and she did today. So I would like to just jump in and introduce and welcome our guest here. Lisa Wong is here. Hi, Lisa. How are you?
Morning, all. How are you all?
Morning, Lisa.
Lisa lives right around the corner from three of us that are here. Barb Buckley, who is our president. Say hi, Barb.
Hi, Lisa.
And myself. And Sonia lives really close to Lisa.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi, Sonia.
And Lisa is running for city council here in North St. Paul. So she's got her signs up in her yard. And I just took it upon myself to invite our neighbor to join us and see what we do. So
nice.
Welcome, Lisa. Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning. Do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself and your campaign and your interests?
Sure. Well, thank you for the invite, Joe, and everyone for having me this morning. Pretty fun group, especially at 7 a.m. I wasn't sure what to expect, so this was a really pleasant surprise, so I appreciate it. So I moved to North St. Paul about 5 years ago, and I was really pleased with being a young couple and having access to the Gateway Trail and having a park around and, still having access to the cities for myself. So it's been a really fun experience for me to be here. I have a background in public policy and public health. So I just finished my degree in that. And so I have a history of also some of that international work that you all focus on. I was in the Peace Corps in 2012 in Ethiopia. That's really special to me and was a really transformative time. So doing some of that work was just transformative. So I think that really embedded a lot of community. I learned how to be a community member, being kind of the only person there. But man, it really showed me some incredible ways to connect with folks and engage with folks. So I really hope that I can bring that to North St. Paul. That's kind of me in a nutshell. I'm really interested in, the park system and making sure that transportation is accessible to everyone and doing what I would have done, you know, maybe in Ethiopia, but also here. So, yeah.
Welcome, welcome cool. Lisa. I have to say that you remind me of Rochelle a lot, and she's not here today. Otherwise, she would have been talking about all your, you know, your life experiences. You guys have parallel lives, it seems.
Yeah. Oh, really? Rochelle?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, definitely. Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
And Lisa, my brother just, I talked to him yesterday. He went online and watched all the YouTube videos of all of the, and you were his favorite. Just want you to know that. That is like, oh, yeah, the best one is that Lisa Wong. I was like, I had no idea who you were. And then here you are today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for coming. That's very meaningful and humbling. So thank you.
Perfect. Now we're going to have to get Nordby on for a call too. We got to give you some inside baseball here, Lisa. One of the other candidates is a son of a former member of ours. So we do have some connections, but as a reminder, there are two seats open. So
it's been, you know, like I've met a few folks and really everyone has a lot to offer and in different ways. So I think whatever happens will be a really well thought out and you know, whoever gets it will do a good job. So,
well, regardless of the outcome, feel free to join us every Friday, any Friday. We're always here. We usually meet at the Keller Golf Club when we're not in the middle of a pandemic, but we don't have that on our calendar anytime soon. So you know where to find us.
Right, thank you,
Joan.
Hopefully I won't sleep in.
It's frowned upon.
As an expert in public policy, what do you think about us not meeting in public?
from a policy and public health background, I think it's wise. it's the least risk, the lowest risk. So, yeah, I think it's a great idea.
Good answer.
Good. I see, I think Rob is also here. Rob's our speaker today, is that right?
I am here.
Hi, Rob. Welcome.
Hi, Rob.
We're going to hear a lot more from you towards the end of the program, but I just wanted to make sure that we all acknowledge you're here, so thank you for coming.
For sure. Thanks for having me.
So I have a question for the group of something I discovered yesterday that you probably all already know, is I had some things I had to drop off a big mailing at the North St. Paul post office and realized, of course, you can't get anywhere near it because of the construction, the fairly sizable construction. What is going in there in the downtown?
I could probably help answer that. So there's a lot of things going on down there. There's a downtown revitalization project that was heavy on utilities that's been in the works for a while. And they're phasing basically all that roadway work. This is phase one. There's going to be a lot more to come. But additionally, kind of across the street from, let me give you a landmark, you know, Newman's, Roddy's, across the street there, which we would usually call maybe the old City Hall lot, is going
Max
to be
Max Dinette.
The Max Dinette lot. That's going to be a
movie theater
housing development, a multi-housing with a retail space on the corner.
Good.
So, yeah, tons of work going on, and it's nowhere near complete, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
So I was
so
on
housing for the most part with some retail on the bottom part. Are there other known projects kind of for the downtown area? It's great to see. It's great to see the life going into it.
There's one more that's kind of start and stop right across from the current City Hall. That's also housing, but that's not really happening right now. So I'm on the design review commission. So everything that gets architecturally reviewed goes across my desk at some point. So I've seen plans for both of those projects and we've approved them, but I'm a step away from the financing and the actual development. So I don't know if that other one's gonna happen. But I was also on the committee to approve the downtown revitalization work. And that's really gonna look pretty great when it's all done.
Fantastic. Where downtown are they gonna put the Joe Stallman Hall of Fame? I mean, is that planned yet, or is it just in the works?
No such thing. No such thing.
I can see a statue of you riding a horse,
right?
This is why I sleep in, you know.
We're hoping to base on that.
A grander, bigger version of Stallman's Pub is waiting to happen down there. I'm sure of it.
Ooh, good idea.
Good idea.
That is. So, Randy, I also was downtown trying to get to the post office, and I was completely off course there. But I ended up over by Rotary Park, and I noticed that our little free library was up. I was so excited, so I drove over there, and I went, oh, it's up. And there were no books in there, so I went back a couple days later, and somebody had some books in there, and so I was it somebody in our club who did that?
I assumed it was going to be full. I'll get over there with some books.
No, I went back over there and I brought over books and I filled it. So, Anne, you had given me some books and I still had them, and yeah, it's filled. So it was really fun to see, though. Very cool.
Yeah, I'm going to put some more into, put some kids' books in and stuff.
Yeah, well, it was plumb full by the time I used all the books that I had and you had. And so hopefully people are taking them. I don't know. It'd be fun to see. But I was so excited. It was great. And the stickers were on the side, so thank you, Sean, for ordering those.
Yep.
Stickers?
Yeah, that says Rotary, North St. Paul, Maplewood, Oakdale, Rotary.
So. Oh. On the
little
library.
Yeah.
It looks real nice.
I owe money too, so put it on my tab, that happy find.
Are there other announcements, or anybody has for some happy bucks this week to share with our, and for those who are visitors today or are new to the club, to the anything raised during their happy bucks, which are announcements, which are things you want to share, which are things you're happy about. Any of the money raised goes to the North St. Paul Food Shelf.
I would like to do 10 happy bucks because I sold my building.
Oh, yay!
Oh. Wow!
And it's to a group called Friends of the Arts. They want to continue what I started and make it a cultural center.
Oh, congratulations!
Oh. I lost 5 pounds.
That's awesome.
So I have one.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So how many people got to eat cheeseburgers at Max Diners while it was still existed? Okay, so I'll tell you a little Max Diner story. The mayor used to, for our fundraiser, donate a dinner out, but the year I wanted it was lunch at Max Diner. So instead of picking me up in a limo like he did for the dinner, I met him there. And so we sit down at a little table that was stuffed way in the back off from the counter and around from the kitchen. And Max, the owner comes out and he's wearing an apron that's all full of grease and blood and stuff with the 2 cups of coffee we had ordered to start. And he puts the mayor's down and he puts mine down and his thumb is in it. And when he sets it down, it's got a cigarette butt floating in it. But the cheeseburgers were good.
Oh god. Randy, a follow up.
Miller's. Oh, go ahead, Bruce.
A follow up on that. When I was a little kid, you know, we used to ride our bikes up and go to the Rialto movie theater up there and watch movies. Right, that was right next to Max. But I just wanted to follow up with my happy find is with Jack Casimius, and shared a little bit about Jack today, but I didn't realize he's been gone for 5 years. It's
incredible. February it'll be 5 years.
Man, it's, but 6-7 years ago, the Casimiuses and myself and a few other members hosted a group from the Czech Republic. And so Jack and I, we all got invited to go to Prague to visit them on a return trip. And Anne was, your daughter was pregnant with one of the grandkids. So I think you flew back
And I stayed home. Katie was like, "Mom, you're not going, are you?" So I stayed home with her. It was her first. She was wanted me to be with her.
Jack and Ann, they kept a modified Goldwing motorcycle that was made into a trike. And I don't know how many thousands of miles they spent driving through Europe, but I flew over, I met Jack, and we got an Airbnb in downtown Prague, and Jack and I spent 10 days. I was on the back of that bike. Every day we'd go out and have another adventure, probably 50, 60 miles outside of town. And I took Ann's spot for the glorious 10 days. And oh, at the end of that trip, we were like brothers. And I'll just give you one quick example. You know, like sometimes we obeyed the rules, but sometimes we didn't. And at this one, we needed to stop in someplace quick. So we pull around a barrier in this parking lot on the trike. And we're trying to get out. And the crossbar won't go up. Says, "Jack, Mogi, get out and lift that thing up." So I got out, lifted it up. He drove under, I hopped back on, and we were out of there. your husband was a wonderful, wonderful man.
And he did always have fun. We always had fun.
So that's a $10. That's a
$10. One of my favorite story.
That's awesome, Bruce.
Thanks, Bruce. A lot of good memories.
Mm.
Sure. I didn't know Jack for very long, but very early on when I joined the club, we had a magician as a speaker and asked for volunteers. So Jack volunteered or was voluntold, and he was like a little munchkin. And so I had that image of Jack being a little munchkin guy. He really was something special, for sure.
He was. He had a big heart.
Oh, yeah. He lit up a room.
Yes, he did.
He did. He was a character. Thank you all.
Well, that was lovely sharing. Thank you. Any other happy bucks?
I just wanted to say, last week I spoke with Linda Miller, and she was very, very thankful to be able to present to our group. And she's like, "Wow, you guys got a rowdy club, and it looks very fun." And I just want to say thank you guys for embracing her and asking her good questions, and walking with her in her journey of being an author and all that. I thought it was very interesting. So she really enjoyed it. And hopefully, it opens up a window for future interests in Rotary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really enjoyed her presentation. I thought it was fun to see the path of a writer. It's not something you're exposed to on a regular basis.
Yeah.
Hey, Sean, on that flag, is that going to work out okay if I drop one off today?
She won't be there until Monday. So she won't be there until Monday.
Oh, you want me to drop it off at your office then?
Yeah, you can do that. I do have a meeting at 10 o'clock out of the office. So I can either pick it up from you or pick it up from Brian.
Well, why don't you send me a note when you're back in the office? Because I got a 10 o'clock appointment too, so I can run it over later in the afternoon or something then.
Okay, sounds
good. You want to tell the club what it's about?
Yeah, so I received a phone call from one of our flag subscribers. She pays for her father's subscription. He's an old war veteran. He's been in the hospital for a few months. I don't remember. It's something. He's on dialysis right now. I'm not exactly sure what he has. She called me and asked me if we could deliver a flag on Monday morning, and that she could have the flag for a couple of days for him, because he loves every flag holiday, seeing that flag out his living room window. He's been in the hospital for a little bit, like I said, but he's going to be coming home on Monday to visit with friends and family, because hospitals won't let that many people into his room right now. She asked for the flag, and I don't know.
Wow. That's awesome.
The doctors told her that once he goes off dialysis, he isn't going to make it very long. So
right.
Home for his final days. And so she wanted to fly the flag while he was still. And then she let us know when we could come and pick it up. So
that's wonderful.
Thanks for making that happen.
Yeah, good job, you too.
All right.
Cool. Any other happy finds? I know we got some business to get to. They're happy, not happy finds.
I've got one more. It's supposed to get up to 80 degrees today, so I've got all five grandkids coming over, and we're going to hang out.
Yeah, should have a luau today.
Oh, yeah, it'll be fun.
Maybe a slip and slide into that pond.
Yeah. Or into the not-so-hot tub.
Yeah, that's hot. Well, yeah, we'll see.
Bruce, is that pond still a lake, or is it back to being a pond?
Well, you know, it's starting to recede, Randy. You know, I can see a large part of the green now, and so my granddaughter says, she's only four. She says, Grandpa, when did it turn from a lake into a swamp? I go, oh, geez. She's right. We're trying to work something out.
Before we finish Happy Box and we go on to our speaker, I have a curious question, Bruce. Is that a self-portrait behind you? It looks kind of, it looks like you a little bit.
This is, okay, I'm going to lift it up. I'll show it to you. This is, that's just some fine art.
You can see some mad scientist there.
The space. If I had a mustache and black hair, I'd be just like it.
I agree. There is some resemblance.
Well, we all know where the happy bucks go, right? All that money we just raised goes to the North St. Paul food shelf. And you can drive right by it now that Sepla Boulevard is two ways.
So
turn it back over to our president, President Buckley.
Okay, thank you, Sergeants of Arms. Birthdays this week. She's not here today, but Rochelle has a birthday on the 10th tomorrow. So send her an email or a text. No?
20th.
What?
October 20th.
Oh, we have it wrong in the...
her husband is the 8th. Maybe that was a confusion.
Okay. Well, we'll get to her then next time. So, okay. Other announcements, Joe Stallman would like to share some information today regarding Polio Plus and some stuff going on with the district.
Yep. Oh, look at that awesome graphic that Sean made for Strikeout Polio Month. So just a reminder that World Polio Day is on October 24th. So the district is doing a push this month to raise more money. Polio Plus is something that the Rotary has been doing for over 30 years. We're the big reason why we are so close to getting rid of that disease across the world. It started off 30 years ago, there's 125 countries, and now we're down to two, just Afghanistan and Pakistan, that have wild poliovirus, and man, we are so close. So this month, and this month only, if you give $100 to Polio Plus, our district will match that with points, and it'll come out as $200 in your name. If you give $365, it's a lot of money, but that will actually become a Paul Harris Fellow. You can become a fellow real easy this month if you wanted to do it that way. If you're already a fellow, or if you want to give that fellowship away to someone that you think deserves it, you can do that too. So you'll see a lot of action this month on the district site. I'm doing a series of interviews with survivors of polio, people who have done immunization trips, medical professionals and such. So watch your social media and your emails for those little video snippets. And remember, let's see if we still know how to do this. How close are we? This close. Awesome. Good job. That's it.
Thanks, Joe, and let's knock it out of the park. Didn't have my bat on hand. And do keep watch on your emails this week.
Barbara, I got a question, not a question, but I received a thing from district, not district, I think international, for this very thing. And do you want our contributions to go through our club or through, or just send it in to international?
Brian Buckmeyer, are you able to speak to that? You're on mute, Brian. I don't know if you can.
I'm off now. You know, I think we need to address this. I think we need to address this through Greg, who's on here too, because the club gives money to International Foundation for both Polio Plus and the general foundation. And Greg usually coordinates this through his grand group. So Greg, how do you think we should address this?
I'm assuming you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm assuming this is a district level program.
Yes.
I'm not familiar with all of the intricacies of this, but I'm assuming it's a district level program. If you just send off the money to Rotary International, I don't think you're going to get the recognition at a district level that they're proposing. So this needs to go somehow through the district. Exact mechanism, I can't answer that question.
I can answer that one. So if you don't want to funnel it through the club directly, you have to be signed up on your, what's it called? You got to have a Rotary.
My Rotary account.
And if you donate through there, the club does get recognized for those points. I don't know how our books work on our end, but from the district side, they'll notice that it came from us. They'll notice that it came from you directly, and you'll get all that recognition. But
I guess the part of it that I don't understand how it works is that the district has to contribute 635 points or something of that nature. And what triggers that contribution on in your name from a district level, I don't know. If you just send in $365, it's not going to happen. There has to be some additional mechanism, and I don't know what that is.
Okay, well, we can.
And I guess as a treasurer, I would prefer if it's the program you're talking about, Joe, it goes directly to the International Foundation and not through our books.
Okay. If anyone wants to do that, why don't you contact me and I will help you walk through it, because we do have specific links to do that with. So we can take that offline.
Okay, that'd be great if you can follow up with that, Joe, so everybody knows.
Thank you.
Do stay tuned though for this week, or for our next week. We might be having a movie shown by Bruce Mogren's son. I think it's called Pterodactyl One or something. We might do that on a Thursday or Friday night, and then we might not have a Friday morning meeting. So Bruce is going to get back to us and let us know what Thursday or Friday this month will work. So stay tuned. I think that's it for announcements. So our program today is Rob Williams. He's an executive director for EveryMeal. This is formerly known as the Sheridan Story. So Rob, if you want to take it off mute and talk to us, and that'd be great.
Good morning.
Morning.
You're in luck. My screaming kids just left, so you won't hear them in the background. My wife was tasked with that this morning. I hope everyone's doing well. It's great to be here virtually. How do I see? Oh, hold on. Okay, here. Now I can see all your beautiful faces. Thanks for having me. So yes, the Sheridan Story is now EveryMeal. I can give you a little background on that to start off. So we started at, well, I'll give you a little, I haven't done a presentation now since we changed our name, so I got to figure it out. We just changed it on Tuesday. So the Sheridan Story began as a program of a church, Mill City Church, in Northeast Minneapolis. It started at Sheridan Elementary School in Northeast Minneapolis. So that's where we get our name. And it still is. It began as a response to the principal at Sheridan School. This is back in 2010. So this is actually our October is of October now is actually our 10-year anniversary, which is also exciting. And we started when the principal said, there's kids at my school, they don't have enough food to eat on the weekends, they're taking extra food at lunch on Fridays, they are having behavioral issues leading up to the weekends, they're kind of sluggish when they come back from the weekend because they don't have nutrition in their system. And she said, is there anything you can do to help the kids in our school? And our response was, yeah, we'll do something. And then we went about trying to figure out what that would be. And we said, why don't we just buy food and put it in bags and give it to the kids so they can take it home every week and have food on the weekends. And so we started in 2010, October 2nd of 2010 were the very first bags of food that we assembled to give to the kids. So it's our 10-year anniversary, 10 years and 7 days today. So 10 years and a week, I guess. And since then, we have grown. We started a separate nonprofit from the church in 2013, still called the Sheridan Story, after the school we started at. And since then, we've provided over 6 million meals to kids throughout Minnesota. We work with the MDE for the migrant school, the Kids of Migrant Workers program in the summers, to give those kids food as well. And we serve, our biggest program is a weekend food program. So we focus on what we call food gaps. So when kids don't have access to meal programs, typically government funded programs that are available at school or other entities like that. And so we focus a lot on weekends, holidays, extended breaks, summers, to make sure those kids have the food that they need to learn and grow, whether there's government funding for those programs or not. So we receive no government funding, except for this year we received $50,000 in a COVID grant. We work in 30 school districts in Minnesota. Including the district that your club covers, the I don't know what order it is, Maplewood, North St. Paul, Oakdale district, something like that, in some order. Those are the cities, and they should come up with different names for the districts or something, because they're all just a list of cities. There's four or five in one district. It's bizarre. The districts we serve covers 37% of all the K-12 kids in the state of Minnesota. We work in about 270 different schools throughout those districts, as well as some charter schools and private, Catholic schools. Almost a month and a week ago, 4 or 5 weeks ago, we found out that Sheridan Elementary School, which was built in 1896, was a very old school, is named after Philip Sheridan, who was a Union general, best known for atrocities that were committed in the Indian, what are known as the Indian Wars, as well as is credited with a very bad quote that people still use today about indigenous peoples. And we do not support being named after someone or affiliated with anything like that. And so the morning after we learned about the name affiliation, we decided to change our name, and in record speed in a month changed our name and announced it on Tuesday. We are now EveryMeal, which the trigger of why we went down the path of changing our name is not positive. It's very exciting to have this new name to bring us forward and kind of better reflects what we do now, being so many schools and not just affiliated with Sheridan School, although we still work there and work closely with them. Actually, the principal, the principal at Sheridan came to our announcement on Tuesday, so it was very fun. the school is also working on changing their name. So that's actually how we found out about it, was their announcement that they were trying to change their name. Their process, I'm sure, will be much more involved than ours, because there's school boards and public people and everything, and we just get to decide. So it's a little easier for us. So with COVID, obviously that's changed everything and basically everything in all of our lives. March 13th was the last Friday prior to school closing. I think the governor announced it on the 15th, which was a Sunday of March. And then the schools closed that Wednesday or Thursday. They had to be closed by then. And so we anticipated that closure. And on that Friday, we asked all of our, at that time, it was about 250 schools to give out all the food that they had, all of our food that they had at their facilities. We typically deliver a month's 3 to 5 week supply of food at a time to a school. So that was a significant amount of food that we asked them to get out into the community. So most of that went out that Friday, or the following Monday or Tuesday. And then from March 13th through the summer, we provided about 100,000 meals a week, which is 4 times more than we normally do. We normally do about 25,000 meals a week. And again, these are focused on kids, getting it to the kids, kids and families. Total from March through September. March through August, we provided 2.2 million meals to kids just in that time period. So again, we've done 6 million total in 10 years, and 2.2 of those were in this last, 6 or 7 months. And so it's been a little bit of a ride. And then we decided to change our name, just needed more to do. And then now, so in September and through this school year, or entering into the school year, we're providing about 56,000 meals a week to kids throughout those districts and areas that we serve. We had to decrease due to lack of funding to be able to buy the food. We buy almost all the food that we provide. Of the $33 million that the government gave to food hunger relief nonprofits, we received, my dog's barking or something, we received only $50,000. And in that time period, we spent about $2 million just on food, just on purchasing food. So our spend rate was about $105,000 a week on the food that we purchased. So we obviously rely significantly on community funding and Rotary funding. We have a lot of Rotaries that partner with us, so we're really grateful for that. So we're really community-based. We work with local partners, churches, companies, Rotaries, other community groups to engage with the schools. Well, when it's not COVID, when you're allowed to volunteer in schools, we have volunteers in schools and that kind of thing. But it's a, very community-based effort. And it is a big part of my life as the founder. Sorry, I'm seeing all these messages pop up. And very meaningful part of my life and what we do at the Sheridan Story. We need a swear jar for the old name, is what someone said. Every time you say the wrong name, you have to put in a dollar or something. But no one has cash, so I don't think that really works. At Every Meal, we really focus on the kids and the impact that it has on those kids. So the food we buy, we want to make sure it's nutritious and delicious so that they'll eat it, but also if they eat it, that is actually helpful nutritionally for their bodies. So it looks like there's questions on the chat. I can start with those, and then I'll read them, reread them. How do schools get involved in your program? From Nina. Pre-COVID, we had an organization that would sponsor each school so that we worked in. So say your Rotary Club wanted to get involved, you would sponsor a school and we'd connect you with them, get involved in this way. And you would typically donate to help cover the cost of some of the food that we provide in that school, and then also volunteer at that school to help distribute the food to the kids at the end of each week so that they had the food on the weekends. Again, obviously with COVID, we don't have volunteers in schools because that doesn't make sense. So things are a little different now, as well as we're broadening for COVID response. We've broadened our efforts to a more district level, to where we support it depends on the school district, but we support the district versus each individual school right now, since they're going in and out of hybrid or in person, or people, you know, some people are distance learning and that kind of thing. So it's a little different now. But basically, if a school wants to get involved, they can contact us. And then we also have outreach to schools when we're looking to add that specific school. Another question from Nina was, do you get food donations? We do receive some food donations. We buy 99% of the food that we provide. Part of that is just a volume thing. We go through, well, like I said, about 56,000 meals a week, and that would be, hold on, I'm doing math in my head, I don't want to hurt myself. So that's about 70,000 different items of foods, like different can or, you know, bag of rice or something a week. So that's just a very high volume. We don't receive food from Second Harvest, Heartland, or the Food Group, which are the two food banks in town. They cannot supply the volume that we do. And so any, you know, the funding that goes to them to buy food to give out to different food shelves and food programs, and they're great. We partner with them. We talk to them all the time. So I have no negative, this isn't a negative statement against them. But we don't benefit from that food, but the community certainly does. Absolutely. As far as like corporate food donate, so we receive like you know, food drive donations or individual donations of food, and we use those to support different programs that we support. And then we don't really get corporate like pallets of donations for the most part. Most of that goes to Second Harvest, which is the Feeding America partner locally. The main food product or like bulk product donor would be Kemp's. We receive some of their, they call giving cows. They're like these little shelf-stable milk, and they actually taste good, which is amazing. With shelf-stable milk, it tastes just like normal milk. That lasts, they're shelf-stable for about a year, so we use some of those. And that is the main like pallets of product donations that we would get. Let's see. Sonia's got a garage sale, day two. Good to know, everybody. Yes, we're headquartered in Roseville, just on the edge of Roseville and St. Anthony / Minneapolis. So it's off of like 35W and County C as in cat, by the big gas tanks, oil tanks, if you guys know where those big white tanks are. So we're on the other side of those. Hopefully they don't blow up. I'm not sure what, sometimes I'm like, that's a lot of stuff that seems not super safe if I'm here. So yes, we're close and we have volunteer opportunities. You can go to our website, everymeal.org, and see volunteer opportunities there. You can sign up as an individual or as a group or club or a book club or family or, you know, whatever makes sense. We have everyone spread out. We have masks and gloves and hand washing and everything, so we keep we keep it all COVID appropriate. And Bruce asked if this is my full-time job. Yes, so I started as a volunteer in 2010 and then in 2013. So my background is in logistics. So I worked for an international logistics company. It's called Expeditors. It's kind of like C.H. Robinson. It's a lot like C.H. Robinson, if you all know who they are. They're headquartered here. Some more people have heard of them. But I was on site at General Mills for a while helping. Actually, this is my General Mills coffee mug with a little dough boy on site there for a while. And then also Target was one of my customers for a while. So I started the nonprofit as a volunteer. And then in 2013, I left that corporate job to start what was then the Sheridan Story part-time, and then went full-time in 2014. Now we have 24 staff that help us make it all happen. So it's crazy. It's a whole thing now. It's bizarre. Lisa, yeah, with the extension at, so Lisa mentioned she works with the extension at the U, I believe is what she's referring to, which is awesome. She mentioned our response in South Minneapolis. So in response to the killing of George Floyd, we had, as you all I'm sure have heard about, so basically all of the grocery stores except for one little neighborhood store, the grocery stores, the gas stations, and all I can think of is pharmacies, drugstores, so it is, they were all closed, they were all damaged and closed, so there's no food in the Longfellow neighborhood, as well as Longfellow being South Minneapolis, as well as along Lake Street, as well as the area of North Minneapolis along Broadway, which was already a food, almost desert in some places, certainly was a food desert in other places. I call them food swamps because there was food, it's just not good food, it's bad food. But then it became a true food desert, meaning literally no food, and as well as along University in St. Paul. So our response in those areas was significant. If you heard of that Sanford Middle School food drive, food collection that they had that sort of shut down the whole South Minneapolis, sorry everyone. That was us, we were running that food collection. We provided, I think it was about 25 semi-trucks worth of food in the 3 to 4 weeks following the rioting and unrest in that area through, I think we had about 30 different partners on the ground there. So that was, a pandemic. This has been a year, y'all. This is not even over, and an election still, so it's crazy. I don't know how strict you all are on time. It's 7:55, and I have a few more questions. I'll try to answer them quickly. What type of asked what type of food we need. The main food items that we provide is shelf-stable food. Now our produce program is ending from the summer. So we do canned fruit, canned vegetables, bags of rice or bags of pasta, chunk chicken, tuna, canned chunk chicken or tuna, that kind of thing. So we loosely follow the USDA My Plate, which used to be the food pyramid. I don't know how long I have to say it used to be the food pyramid, because it's like it's a long time ago now that it used to be the food pyramid, but Bruce asked if we get feedback from the kids and their parents. Yeah, we do. We have focus groups. We have annual surveys that we have the families do. We have focus groups and we have taste testings to make sure the food is, like I said, nutritious or delicious. And then we have a dietitian on staff to make sure it's nutritious. So we put a lot of thought and effort and money into the food we provide. We don't just give ramen noodles. They get enough you know, salt in their lives already. So it's not just about them feeling, not having the sensation, the feeling of hunger. It's about them actually having the nutrition they need. You know, we could give them ramen noodles or chips or something cheaper and they wouldn't feel hungry, but that's not really the point. So the ultimate goal is so that they can pay attention and learn in school while they're in class and that their bodies can physically develop. So I think that's all of the questions that I see. I'm game if anyone else has more questions, or I can turn it back over to President.
Anybody else have any other questions for Rob?
Thank you for doing that.
Not a question, but I just want to say it's a fabulous organization who's been very responsive to community needs. And I personally want to say thank you, because in the migrant program, the families that actually pick our food can't afford quality food. And so we have been partnering with them for the last, I want to say, seven, 8 years. And all the way up to Moorhead and Rochester and Worthington. Rickenridge. I mean, all over the state. So thank
Body
you.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. And we love the partnership with MDE. It's, we love being able to serve that community where otherwise we wouldn't be able to. Claudia asked, what way would we prefer to get help, food donations, volunteers, or money? Those are all important. I would say volunteers are super important, and the funding is super important, because that's how we buy the food. So the volunteers come in and they actually assemble the bags of food so that we can get them out. We have various different menus of items that we give to the kids. So that's very important. And then the funding to buy the food obviously is very important as well. We can buy more food with a dollar than the average consumer, obviously, because we buy in semi-truckloads of food. So, yeah.
Good. Great program, Rob. Great program.
Thank you. And thank you for all your support in the various different ways.
And as Sonia's mentioned, through our community avenue of service, our club has contributed to every meal. And our schools have received the benefits of every meal. So it's happening here locally.
For sure. Yep. Thank you so much. And yeah, if you want to volunteer, you just go to our website. You can either as a club, you know, a group of people, or as an individual, or we have various times in the day and evenings and stuff. So
it's a great opportunity to be people of action. So maybe we can organize this as a community service thing. Let's
and
do
it's it. Fun. We play music and it's a good time.
Yep.
Sounds great.
For your fifth tenant.
Okay. Thank you so much, Rob Williams, for sharing what's happening with Every Meal. This is a vital program in our communities, and we appreciate all the work and everything that you do and the organization does. Our inspirational quote for today is, "Hunger is a real life-threatening pandemic that is plaguing the lives of young Americans. It is a rumble in the stomach that demands to be silenced." And this was by Brett Servin, a 2013 No Hungry Kid Essay Contest winner. Lisa, thanks for joining us, and everybody have a great weekend. Meeting is adjourned. Thanks again, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, Rob.
Thank you.
Thank you. Great job.